You are listening to Freethinker Radio on 90.1 KPFT Houston. My name is Derrick Broze, and I'm here with Micah Jackson.
Hey, hey, glad to be here. Glad y'all are listening to KPFT.
Yeah, thanks for tuning in, everyone. I was gone last week. How was it, Micah? What was going on?
It was a pretty fun show, you know. Had a lot of interesting news and got into some music. A little bit different than, not so different than usual, but it was a little different. So, as always, if you missed that episode or want to get into this one later, the archives are out there via kpft.org, which is a great site to visit no matter what to discover other shows and such. But also check out the Houston Freethinkers on YouTube. You can find all our archives to last week's episode as well as all the musical guests that we've had loaded up right there. And thanks to everybody who has already liked the page and invited like-minded people to like the page. We're working hard to reach the doers and people who are interested in music and news.
And we are alone here at the studio. Today is, if you didn't know, it's July 4th. It's something sort of resembling Independence Day in America. And there's no one here at the studio, so we have all to ourselves.
We're independent.
We're independent. We're independent women, and we're doing our own thing. And so thanks for being here. Be sure to follow us on Facebook, Freethinker Radio, Visionary Noise, the Houston Freethinkers. You can like all those pages, click get notifications, and you'll stay plugged into all of our upcoming events, radio shows, benefit shows, music events, activism, everything that our
interviews,
everything that our community is connected to. You can also, as Micah said, subscribe to the YouTube channel, both Houston Freethinkers and Visionary Noise YouTube channel for more music and other events coming up. And lastly, if you're on Twitter, you can follow Micah and I'm at DBrosLiveFree, and Micah is at Visionary Noise. And if you have questions you want to tweet at us, feel free to do that. Or if you want to be old-fashioned and call us on the phone, you can call us at 713-526-8737. And again, I've been told I say that number too fast, so 713-526-8737. We're here all day and ready to talk to you about what's happening.
Not here all day.
Well, all day for the next 2 hours.
Definitely, definitely. Please call in 713-526-8737. And we want to talk to about, you know, what Independence Day means to you.
Yeah, that's a good question. We have guests coming up today, too. We've got already in the studio, but going to talk with us here in the second hour.
What does 4th of July mean to us?
We got Sparrow from Your Friendly Neighborhood Anarchist, and also from Monkari, also involved with the North Houston Freethinkers. Is going to talk to us in just a little bit. And we're expecting a phone call in the next 5 to 10 minutes from a good friend of ours from the community, Joanna, who is involved with Peace Camp Houston. So we'll hear more about what they're doing and, yeah, find out what's happening. I'll catch you guys up with why I was gone last week, just briefly, while we talk about some upcoming events in the city. I was in Austin for a Freedom Cell meeting, which is, I talked briefly about this in the past before, but it's a decentralized peer-to-peer network, a group of people who are coming together to educate each other, to organize, to strategize, and to get things done, whether that means teaching each other skills, knowledge, activism, community protection, gardening, all sorts of things like that. So we were working on that concept in Houston, and we're also working on that concept in other cities, and including Grand Rapids, Michigan, Austin, Texas. I've talked to people in New Zealand and Colorado and South America, others who are like, oh, wow, we never heard of this concept, this idea of, some people know it as octologs or freedom cells, affinity groups. We call them freedom cells, but it's a growing idea. There's a new Facebook page if you want to check it out. Search freedom cells.
I call them a circle.
And circle, maybe add another word to that. But I do want to say, let me remind you guys that we are posting all the links and everything that we're going to cover. The news is going to be on the Freethinker Radio Facebook page. We don't have an event for today, but if you're on Facebook and you want to follow along to all the articles and the events we're talking about, go to the pinned post, the top post that we have there on the page, and we'll post them all in that thread. And you and your friends can comment and follow along, or again, call to voice your opinion. But if you want to know more about freedom cells, I'll post a couple links there to some videos I've done. One is called What is a Freedom Cell, and I'll post a link to the freedom cells page. But I do want to say I'm very excited for those who are looking for a way to organize in their community and to try to take this dissatisfaction that many people are feeling because of the elections and because of just all the division that's taking place in the U.S. and really all around the world, immigration issues, just everything that divides people. We're trying to find ways to make our community is more cohesive and more organized, and I think Freedom Cells is a valuable tool for that.
Definitely, definitely.
What were you up to, Micah? What did you do last week? What were you talking about last week? What did you do this weekend?
What is this? Are you with the government? I mean, good God.
Papers, please.
Oh, man. It was a good weekend. I got out to the Heights Epicurean Market on Heights, and our friend Jeffer Thomason played a set. Some Bloodsucking Fiends played a set, and a musician who's played with, like, the Temptations and many known acts like that. Ricky Ford played a set. There were probably about... offhand 18 or 22 different vendors selling stuff, and that was really good, you know, out there, people believing that they can do something, create something, and put it out there, and people would you know, appreciate it. So, you know, a lot of non-GMO foods as well, and organic honey and olive oil and all this stuff right here available. Nice. In and most of it from the community. So that's always a positive thing to be involved with, and you know, meet people, talk about what's going on, and share, you know, local music. I actually I MC out there, and I talk about KPFT, and I you know, I play I played K Reno and Cliche to a bunch of people at a farmer's market that may never hear some of this type of music. So that's always a fun thing to do, and realize that all these things where people are is a place to get out of your comfort zone and, you know, find people with similar ideas, even if they don't look, smell, act like, or listen to the same music as you. So that was fun. Then I headed over to the South Park and enjoyed the Hustle Hard Block Explosion. I always want to call it Block Party, but Block Explosion. And I think maybe that's too narrow of a word, because you'd never seen anything like it, Derrick. All these cars were parked up on the median, because that's where all the shade was. And just people packed out cooking foods. They had snow cones. And unity in the community was the theme. Peace in the hood.
I can get down with a snow cone.
Heck yeah, me too, man. Especially on days like this. I hadn't had one in, honestly, probably more than a decade.
And snow cone.
Yeah, definitely. I think it was Zero that said the barbecue potatoes re-resurrected him. Because it was hot out there.
Gotta get down on them potatoes.
But yeah, Ganesha played an awesome set with Cliche, which was pretty interesting. We played Ganesha on here, and they're known around town.
They get around.
Yeah, for sure. And Cliche was tearing it up, so it was really interesting energy to hear her sing with them like that.
We had her on the show a few weeks ago, for those who missed that. That's on the YouTube channel.
Yeah, definitely. And I'll probably, when we go to a break or something, try to find and share that episode out there. So thanks to everybody who does share anything that we put out there. And if you have any ideas or comments on these articles, you know, disagree or agree or have more information on, we're always open to, you know, look at that as well. So, you know, we want to open a dialogue with everybody that's involved. And then that evening, I went out to Rudyard's, which, of course, is here in the heart of Montrose, much like KPFT, and checked out six metal bands, one from Ottawa and Saginaw, and we were playing them the week before, so it was really interesting to get into it, kind of a metalcore type show. And Treason, our own local support and band, was there, and they did an amazing job. So that was a good night. And, you know, it was kind of a strange day, I guess, because of the holiday weekend and everything, just all through the day, different people, just everybody moving. I don't know. I don't feel like there were as huge a crowds at most of the events as I thought there might be. Although they were all well attended, I think it maybe just everything was divided up, so some people were in different places. Oh, we got a red blinking light. We may have a interview or a caller. And like we said, if you've got anything to say, call 713-JAM-TRACE. That's, we're all here on the HD3. I'm going to let y'all know about some upcoming events. We got the downtown Houston pub crawl kicking off Saturday. You can get all into that. And it's basically, you know, if you want to ride around and drink beer, that's what's going on. Then you may have heard of our friend Jeremy Carswell. We've played him here a few times. He's played for the community and some benefit shows, and getting all around town. He's got a great album, 2025. He's playing at Barbarella's July 6th. Do we have a interview?
I believe we have Joanna on the line. Joanna, are you there? Joanna?
Yes.
Hey. How are you? Welcome to the show.
Thanks.
So we wanted to talk with you. Me and Micah are just... Say hi to Micah. Micah's here.
Hi, Joanna.
Hey, Micah. How's it going?
It's going pretty good. Pretty good, you know.
How's your 4th of July?
Well, you know, we're in here getting to talk to people and play great music and hang out with friends and talk about things like what you have going on over there. So that's pretty good. You know, I feel like, you know, even if with all the trouble surrounding 4th of July, you know, in a way, all this is still working for our independence. So I think it couldn't be a more fitting day to be on the radio.
It's true. It's good to just get out and see people. Like, we were not sure if we wanted to do something today or just stay in because we get the day off. But we went out to the Barrio Dogs meet up in the east side today, and that was just nice to get out there and see people.
Nice.
Now, well, I'm baking cherry strawberry pie.
Oh, man.
Which I must take out of the oven right now.
Can we sample some of that?
Yeah, through the radio.
For those who don't know,
for
those who don't know, a couple weeks ago we had the Houston Garden Crawl, which we talked a lot about, the bikes and the gardens and music and everything. Joanna was there. She met us up at the mystery spot at the near the hill at the museum district by the zoo, and she had awesome pizza made from local ingredients and just good stuff, veggie pizza. And Joanna is an amazing, awesome cook and just somebody who's doing good work in the community. And that's why we wanted to have you on today. Specifically, though, we wanted to hear more about Peace Camp. And could you go ahead and just tell us a little bit about Peace Camp, how it got started, what your job is, and how people can get involved themselves?
Sure, yeah. So I got involved with Peace Camp myself just pretty recently. This is my second summer. It's a summer camp only, but it is sponsored by the Houston Peace and Justice Center, which is a year-round activism organization. And it was, so Peace Camp itself was started about 14 years ago by some activists that wanted to teach a peace and justice curriculum to students and children, because they're the next generation, and it's so important. And so they started with a small camp, like 1 week a summer. And Judy Hawkine, who had been a teacher herself for many years in and around Houston, and she also was worked with the Peace Corps in Jamaica and taught high school there for a few years. And I believe then she came back here to Houston, taught a few more years, retired, and then went in and worked with Peace Camp. And it's been building up over the last 14 years, and now we do 6 sessions per summer. I'm the music teacher, and that's like a great job for me. I was always a musician, and in the last few years since I became a mother, I got out of music because it had been sort of more of a nighttime career, and it was harder to keep up with that with the kids. And so I was doing some baking down at the last organic outpost with the pizza stuff, and met some folks there. Tracy, maybe you guys know Tracy from Food Not Bombs.
Yep.
She had been working with Peace Camp, and her kids had been involved, and they needed a new music teacher. So, and I'd just done little fun, almost like karaoke style stuff at the garden with my keyboard and people coming up on the stage and singing pop songs and stuff. And so then I interviewed with Peace Camp, and the rest is history. But, yeah, I hope it continues, because this is, like, the best job I've ever had. It just combines all the things I like to do, music, and then I've also gotten involved in crafts there. We're doing recycled crafts this year for the first time. And, yeah, so that's my part, and that's kind of just a brief history. But
that sounds really interesting. That sounds really interesting, Joanna. And I, you know, you being on today motivated me to just, you know, check out the page and learn a little bit more about it. You know, when you talked about, I was going to ask a question, but you kind of answered part of it. And I was going to ask you, you know, and I know you're the, like you said, a music teacher, but I guess it says in the short description, and you also reiterated this somewhat, that it's a, the Peace Camp is a day camp experience which fosters an understanding of peace, justice, and environmental awareness. Okay, you spoke to environmental awareness somewhat with recycled crafts, but I was wondering if you could give us, you know, an explanation or an example or something concrete about how you've seen that, I guess, for lack of a better phrase, mission statement actually, occurring there. Because, I mean, that's a valuable thing, peace, justice, and environmental awareness. But what methods are used to, you know, bring these to children's minds?
Right. So, yeah, that's a good point. It is, it's not ballerina camp or swimming camp. We're talking about how to find inner peace. And we do that through meditation, yoga, cooperative games. So we're concentrating on building the cooperative skills and about what we can make together rather than what we can, you know, who can be the fastest and who's going to win this race. I think Judy was saying that that was one of the things that really turned her off when she was working in the public schools was they'd have these field days and some kids really excelled at the sports, but then the ones who were on the losing end would get their heart broken, and it wasn't fun for everyone. So I think that was one of her main goals in going to start the peace camp is focusing on cooperation, not competition. And so that aspect, and my husband Nathan has been doing the cooperative games, and he's a philosopher and been really into that for the last 2 years too, so he's been involved. And we have other people. We have guests from the community that come in who are our local peacemakers. And it's really nice to have just varying influences.
Certainly.
Coming in from all over the place. Like we had Nick Cooper teach some capoeira, which is like a Brazilian martial art. But it's really, you do it very slowly. So you're kind of fighting, but it's almost sort of like this relational dance, and we did drumming as well with that, and we had Noah Rappler, who is someone that did a walk back in 2005 from Houston to Los Angeles in order to raise awareness of homeless populations, and so he wrote a book called Noah's Walk, and he's usually there, like every session of peace camp, we get a visit from Noah. And the kids get to ask them questions and learn about how they got into activism. We once had a Muslim family come in and just talk to the kids about their traditions. And that was awesome just to focus on how they're, like, different traditions. People are different around the world, different cultures.
Definitely. That sounds like a great thing for children to have an opportunity at an early age and in a comfortable environment to be able to have these things, you know, deliberately brought through their attention span. So that's really interesting, and I'm glad that you've come on and, you know, shared what's going on there. And the fact that, you know, a lot of people, you're really a nice person, and the fact that you say this is one of the best jobs you've had makes, you know, peace camp sound pretty peaceful.
What's the next peace camp? When does it start? Or how, you said there's six sessions throughout the summer. How many are left? Or how can people find out about that?
Right. Just finished a week at the Shape Center here in Third Ward, which is my neighborhood. And we have a two-week break. We're breaking this week for 4th of July. And then we'll start up again July 18th at the Cameron Retreat Center. And that's over in the Medical District. And it's July 18th through the 22nd. And then the week right after that, we're going to be at Emerson Unitarian Church. And that's July 25th through the 29th. And that's the last session that's open to the public. We do a week at the beginning of August for the women's shelter. But that's closed just for those kids there.
Awesome. That's really powerful. Is there a website or a Facebook that we can send people to?
Yes, both. There's peacecamphouston.org, and there's a link that you can follow and register your kids. It's really easy. There's also scholarships available for kids that, or for parents that maybe can't pay the full fee, so that's okay. We usually have a lot of kids on scholarship, but it is also, I think, one of the less expensive camps in town. What is that?
I was kind of like, what's the age range?
Oh, yeah, right. So it is from ages 5 to 17.
Okay, and, darn, I'm too old.
Yeah, and we will split up the groups, and the teenagers will go off and do just like a more in-depth research of peace and justice curriculum, and then the younger ones will learn through other ways, like puppets, drama. So it's a little, it's slightly different between the both, and then also the teenagers are come on as volunteers, so they'll be cooking and helping make snacks for the small ones. So I think there is not a charge for teenagers, it's just the kids.
Awesome. Well, thank you so much, Joanna, for calling in and for telling our audience about Peace Camp. I was excited to hear about it. I hadn't really realized that the Houston Peace and Justice Center was working on, was doing that. And they, like you said, they've been doing it for quite some time. They do great work. Everyone check them out. And if you have children, I know we have friends and family within our community that would probably be interested in being involved with something like that. So thank you for your time. Anything else you want to leave us with before we let you go?
Oh, yes. I did want to say that it's kind of an anarchist camp in the sense that it's us building it, and it gets better with what we bring to it. And so if anyone has would like to come in and be a guest and has something to offer in that way, just send us a message over the Facebook. That's me, so I can get back to you. I can hook you up with Judy. We would just love to be exposed to all different kinds of things at Peace Camp. There's no limit.
Awesome. We will make sure that we pass the word along. Thank you so much, Joanna.
Okay.
Talk to you soon.
Thank you. Bye.
All right, that was Joanna with Peace Camp Houston and many other activism efforts, community efforts here in Houston. That sounds really interesting. If I had some kids, that's probably more like what I would be sending them to than some other mainstream type of camp. And yeah, we're going to go to a song. Check out this. This is from Metanoia, who is playing earlier. If you were listening at the beginning of the show and you heard some of that progressive metal, that was The Earth as We Know It. Them, Metanoia, who you're about to hear, So Soon the Truth, my band Monankari, and Your Friendly Neighborhood Anarchists, who we will hear from in the second half of the show, are all playing this Friday night at Fitzgerald's for just $5. Fitz in the Heights, the classic venue Fitz. Come check it out. Five bands, $5, presented by Visionary Noise. And you're going to hear from those artists and more. And later, I do want to debut a song that's actually not from a Houston artist. Usually we promote Houston music to support our community. But there's another artist that I'd like to promote this show and support. His name is, well, we'll keep that a secret for now, but he's a musician. He's a conscious musician from another city who supports the Houston Freethinkers. He supports our efforts. He might even be listening right now, and we're going to release one of his new songs and put it out there for the people.
Is he with the NSA?
He's not with the NSA, unfortunately. We couldn't get them again. I know they're very difficult to book, but maybe
next time.
They're always
listening.
They're always listening, though. But check this out. This is We Will Rise from Metanoia here on Freethinker Radio, 90.1 KPFT Houston. Stay tuned.
Tomorrow.
Welcome back to Freethinker Radio on 90.1 KPFT Houston. My name is Derrick Broze, and I'm here with Micah Jackson. You just listened to We Are One from Metanoia, and then before that, that was a live version of them playing the song We Will Rise.
So we can go catch them live?
Yeah, you can catch them live.
Friday?
Friday night at
Fitzgerald's.
Fitzgerald's in the Heights for $5.
Nice, nice. I wanted to also mention that Thursday you can catch something else live. That's actually the band name, something else. You can catch it live at Fitzgerald's. You might also catch something else at Fitzgerald's. I don't know. But
yeah, be careful
do what,
what
you got to do what you got to do, you know.
Be careful what you do in those bathrooms.
Stay hydrated.
Stay hydrated. That's always drink more water. If you're not feeling it, drink more water. All right. There's a couple other events before we move on to local news and then national and then move on with the rest of the show and talk to our guests. There's some things going on tomorrow. There's an event called U.S. Hands Off Venezuela tomorrow from 3 to 5 p.m. downtown at the Mickey Leland Federal Building, created by the Houston Friends of Venezuela. It says, July 5th is the anniversary of the independence of the Bolivarian Republic of Venezuela. On that day, we will be demanding the end of U.S. intervention in the internal affairs of the Venezuelan people. While in Mexico, the government of Enrique Peña Nieto massacred defenseless teachers and workers. The U.S. government says nothing to denounce the killing of teachers and the violation of human rights. However, the Obama administration maintains that Venezuela is a threat to the national security of the United States. Join us to say, hands off Venezuela, rally at downtown federal building. So, yeah, if you want to check that out, that's going on there. And I will post that with the other news and events on the Freethinker Radio Facebook page. And I got one more here that you guys out there might be, you guys and gals might be interested in getting involved in. Because if you haven't noticed, we're trying to get you guys to get out from just, you know, sitting behind the computer screen, behind the telephone, the radio, whatever, and to get out there in your community, get involved, whether it's activism that we're doing or other events going on. One other thing that you should really check out if you have the opportunity is an event tomorrow night at the Jenner House. And we talked about this, the Jenner House, which is an art house, poetry house, music space. It's been around Houston for quite some time, and it's going to be sold very soon. It won't be around very much longer. I don't think it's going to make it through the month of July from what I've been told. But the Manifesto Forum, which is a local poetry group, will be doing their grand finale at the Jenner House tomorrow night. And it's also the Tuesday is the open mic at Jenner House usually. So I think this is in line with that. And they're saying the Jenner House will kick off a grand finale on Tuesday, July 5th due to the venue being sold by the owner. Come out and, you know, celebrate poetry, music, community, art. That is tomorrow night at the Jenner House. And again, I'll post that on the Freethinker Radio Facebook page. And I think I got one more here.
I got a couple of events as well. Ganesh is going to be hitting Warehouse Live this weekend, so that should be pretty interesting, along with the Schisms, the Infamists, and Vanilla Well. And if you haven't heard about these annual days of music free from the Houston Symphony, something to get into Saturday, they... you know, basically, showcase a diverse musical landscape at Jones Hall. So it's a chance to go to Jones Hall, check out some symphonic music for free, meet some people, get out of your comfort zone. Also, Sunday is the East End Market. If you haven't been out there, it's out on 2800 Navigation. You know, we definitely want to support these local markets as much as we can, and your industry as well. So
the East End's there every Sunday too.
Yeah. Yep. So got those things going on. And if this is all going really fast, I know we've been told that we say the phone numbers fast. I imagine we say other things fast as well. Remember, you can always find these and these events and all the source material for the news articles that we cover on the chat string on Freethinker Radio.
The reason we're fast is because there's so much going on. And even with 2 hours to talk to you guys once a week, it's really not enough to cover all the important things. You know, we keep our eyes and ears glued to news related to philosophy, politics, science, technology, you know, our own community, plus try to just squeeze in good, you know, community events in there. And there's a lot to cover. So, yeah, please do check out the sources for everything. But let's get into local news.
Yeah.
What you got over there, sir?
All right, well, fire round one, huh? Let's see. I got a variety of stuff. So many things open. So many things going on. But let's start with Houston ISD. The Houston ISD board is under fire, believe it or not, for bribery and corruption charges. And you get all into this, but any school teacher will tell you that normally 2 plus 2 equals 4, but at Houston ISD administrative building, sometimes 2 plus 2 equals 5, particularly when that extra 1 is part of a scheme to overcharge the school district for construction work, or as a bribe that was allegedly paid to a school board member to secure a contract. Houston ISD's shady math on construction contracts came to light a while back when the board dismissed the district's chief auditor. Turns out the auditor was going through the district's financials, in other words, doing his job, when he noticed that the construction contractors hired by the district were doing some strange stuff with work orders. HISD has a policy that any expenditure of more than $500,000 has to be approved by the board. State law is pretty clear that the contractors can't split up work orders to keep the costs of the project below a cap. So basically, they're splitting up the work orders, going around it, and they'll submit three $500,000 ones for a $1.5 million job to get around the board, do things like that. This article is quite a bit longer than that. It goes on and it talks about people who served the district for one form or another for 50 years and why they didn't seek re-election. And I imagine we'll hear a lot more about this. The district is also planning to spend $2 to $5 million to rechristen schools named after Texans and generals who fought for the Confederacy during the Civil War. The price tag for renaming plan is, you know, you can expect to be paying out of that. All this that proves so much that a lawsuit has come to bear on that. So
what do you guys think out there? If you want to call in 713-526-8737 about the idea of, you know, of course we should recognize the crimes and the violations that have taken place in the past, and especially when they've been commonly accepted by the state and by the governing institutions. But should we erase that history, you know, through tearing down statues and renaming streets and things like that? You know, obviously, if you get a street named after you, it probably seems like it's a tribute to that person. And then many times we recognize the actions taking place during slavery and other dark periods of U.S. history and world history. It seems like maybe we don't want to recognize some of these people, you know. But then again, to me, the average person recognizes and looks up to the presidents, the people that are on our money, the dollars and such. And I don't necessarily feel like those people are worthy of our worship or reverence and things like that. You know, maybe some of them are, but definitely not all their actions. So it's interesting because some people will revere one set of individuals and then tell you to look down upon other. But maybe the problem is hero worship in general.
Another thing to remember is that as long as we're talking about all this stuff, that the Coinage Act originally didn't allow for presidential and individual figures to be on the money. We weren't going to have any kings or queens on the money and no icons like that. So it was originally supposed to be, you know, a figure to represent liberty, not necessarily, you know, Andrew Jackson or, you know, these type of questionable people. But I got a bunch of other stories, if you don't mind, Derrick. I'd like to hit this one. This is the Houston Police Department are going to increase patrols in response to Kush calls. How do you like that?
Yeah, we saw there was like a week ago at Herman Park, there was like an emergency where there was like 5 to 10 people who had to go to the hospital for
Kush. More than a dozen in one day.
Kush is the fake weed.
Yeah.
For those who don't know.
Yeah, we're going to get into this. Mayor Turner announced that he's going to increase the patrol in the shadow of Herman Park Pavilion, where 16 people were taken to the hospital with symptoms resembling that of a Kush overdose. Kush, sometimes called synthetic marijuana or spice, fake bake, blah, 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 is a chemically manufactured drug that has been plaguing cities around the country. According to statistics provided Thursday, the fire department, this is mind-blowing, the fire department, Houston Fire Department, has responded to almost 1,400 Kush-related overdoses since September. Jeez. That's in less than a year.
And this is a legal thing. It says not for human consumption, but this is 1,400 people that managed to call the fire department. Okay, for trying to smoke something that is largely thought of as a replacement to these people of the illegal drug marijuana. So many people believe that, you know, they're safer, you know, because this is something they can acquire. It turns out that Turner's plan includes adding 175 officers on the streets, 13 more park rangers, and various overtime opportunities for HPD officers. Overtime. See what Kush is doing to us? Turner said he hopes the increased patrols will help not only target those breaking the law, but also help those who are abusing the drugs. Yeah, because they're going to help you, you know, help you. When I start...
We're from the government. We're here to help.
Yeah, on overtime. Yeah, yep. And it goes in...
Stop smoking fake weed.
Yeah, do you need the government to tell you to not do heroin? And if you do, you know, I really want to hear an explanation for why you do.
Well, I think that our point, you know, we kind of make jokes about it, but our point is that really that as people, as individuals, as free people, we're capable of making decisions about what goes in our body, and that doesn't mean we always make the right decisions or the healthiest decisions. You know, we make decisions that end up with us addictions and getting going down certain roads, but that's in each individual's right to make the wrong decision as much as it is the decision that you view as right. And really, you have to ask yourself, if you're not free to alter your state of mind, whether that's through a plant, a beer, or a movie, or, you know, whatever it may be. Yeah, whose mind is it? Do you own your own mind? Do you own yourself if you can't even control it?
Next thing you know, they'll be taking my thoughts away.
Coming after your thoughts, trying to get up in your
head. Got a ton more, man, and we ain't even got out of Houston.
Well, let me lay one Houston on you. This is something that I thought was kind of interesting because it came from just somebody reaching out to me and saying, hey, can you look into this this story? Basically, it was a friend saying that a couple months ago, there was a fire that happened here in Houston, and I hadn't even heard about this. And it was on the west side of town near Spring Branch Drive. The company was called Custom Packaging and Filing Company. That's the name, real generic. They're on the 1700 block of Laverne Street near Spring Branch Drive on the west side of town near the Spring Branch Creek. And there was an explosion at this warehouse that was just housing certain chemicals. And this red, like, fluid went all into the Spring Branch Creek, like runoff in there. There's a bunch of pictures of people seeing it, and it was like a 4-alarm fire. So this is in early May, right? And a friend reached out and was like, hey, I live near that fire. Do you think you could look into it and see what was in those chemicals or what was in, you know, these containers? And so I'd never even heard of it. I started doing research, and I found that the week afterwards, there was a city council meeting. This is according to the Houston Chronicle. First-time officials released the names of at least some of the chemicals at Custom Packaging. The chemicals were a combination of pesticides and petroleum-based products. None of them was rated highly for toxicity or flammability, according to the ratings by the National Fire Protection Association. So I had a friend that reached out and said, hey, I live near there. I've been having a lot of headaches. I've been having to go to the doctor like since that happened. I think I might be having some kind of neurological problems. Do you think you could do some research and find out what was going on? So I started to look more into it. They're definitely pesticides. They're water soluble, and they went into that creek. But it said, you know, and this is a report again back in May, results may be available today. With the recent rain and flooding, dilution of contaminants may lessen the environmental impact. And of course, the government is taking the stance that they always take immediately that, oh, these are safe. There's no health risk to anybody. Don't worry about it. It's just pesticides and some sort of, you know, petroleum additives spilling into the water and in the air through the smoke. And they promise that it's okay. So I reached out to the Texas Commission on Environmental Quality, which is basically the EPA, the Environmental Protection Agency for the state. And this is what she told me. She said, this matter is still under investigation. Once the investigation is completed and the investigation report is final, we can share the information you request. However, based on review of the available sampling data to date, the city, TCEQ, and the EPA all agree that there is no threat to the public health. Yet I just find it sort of fishy, and I feel like they're trying to just brush it under the rug that it's been 2 months since this fire and explosion, and they still have not released to the public, you know? And also I wasn't really doing this to write an article. It was just a friend asking me to do some research for her. So I emailed the TCEQ like anybody else, and the email I got, it was a little bit snippy. It was like, I understand that you work for a media outlet. All requests for the media need to go through our media relations office. Like, she was basically like, I wasn't trying to pull a fast one on her or anything, like not identify that, hey, I'm a freelance journalist or whatever, but I wasn't really calling in that capacity to, you know, for information about an article. And I think that typically agencies like this, especially when there's an accident, they seem to be weary of journalism because they're just, you know, they have their official statement. They're going to keep saying there's no risk to public health until somebody can prove otherwise, you know what I mean? And at this point, they're the ones with the data. But if everything's cool, why would it take them 2 months since this explosion and this leak to release a public report of what chemicals were there and tell us that they're safe, you know? So that's just sort of something I'm investigating, and I will continue to look into that. If anybody else has information related to that, please contact us either through the Facebook page. You can find me on Facebook, or just send a message to Freethinker Radio on Facebook.
Wow. Yeah, that's, you know, one thing about this is, you know, a lot of these stories that do have a, you know, that develop into a story do start by someone asking a question or sending a picture or something. So I never want to shut that out. If you're out there and you know something that's going on, or you question something that's going on, feel free to message the Freethinker Radio page with that. In fact, some of our better experiences have been from that. I thought this one was kind of crazy. So we got people out there, 1,400 plus in less than a year, calling the fire department for ODing on Kush. And you got to hear what these sheriff's deputies did, because they thought someone had some weed, you know, the illegal one that people aren't ODing on or whatever. So this turns out that a couple of Harris County sheriff's deputies got indicted Thursday for what some might call a power trip or something. The indictment actually reads as official oppression, which is a misdemeanor. You know, oppression is a misdemeanor. Wow.
It's not bad.
Yeah, not bad. You could do a little oppression.
You can get off with just a misdemeanor after officially oppressing people.
Yeah.
It's not too bad.
You get a fine maybe of up to $4,000 and maybe a year in county. The problem is the language doesn't really describe what happened. At around 10:30, these two individuals, two ladies, were going to the store to get something, and basically rolled through a stop sign. Y'all, rolling through that stop sign. That's what the Sheriff's County deputy put in the, or is according to, I've read like three stories on this one, so I'm sorry, that's what their attorney said. And after the deputies hit their lights, they pulled over the car at a Texaco station, and a deputy said that they smelled marijuana. So they asked the Corley to get out of the car, and asked the suspect to, quote, step into his office, and placed the female
into my office, back
of the patrol car. They searched the car and didn't find anything, allegedly. I've seen different things so far. When the unnamed deputy came back to the patrol car, he told her that he smelled marijuana in the patrol car.
Oh,
now.
Damn. Is this the one I think?
Yeah, it is. The deputy then radioed for a female deputy to come to the scene. Two lady cops showed up, and basically, they told her to drop her pants, and she told them, well, she was going commando at the time, and the female...
Tricks on you? I didn't even wear it.
Yeah. They said that it didn't matter if she was free buffing or rocking Victoria's Secret. She still had to
take
drop
it
trial.
Off.
So, you know, she said she had a little bit of hesitation about, you know...
God, these people.
...public lewdness and all this type of stuff, and getting half naked in a parking lot, a gas station. Deputies said she resisted the search because, you know, she asked these things. And when she failed to reply in what they thought was enough time, they handcuffed her, took her pants off, and laid her out on the parking lot. That's right. Right there in the gas station. You know, this is the power these people have. You know, so anyway.
Yeah,
so,
would you be able to, you think, how do you guys think that...
That was
you
your
know,
mom, your sister.
...the world would handle if you went up to somebody and just grabbed them, forced them down the ground, and say, you know, you can do whatever to them. You think that you're going to get off easy?
Technically, it's illegal
official oppression?
To go and, like, search people, you know, naked in a parking lot. If I went and did that, or you went and did that, we'd get arrested for public indecency or something, you know?
Was this the cavity search thing?
Yeah. So they say they found about 0.02 ounces. That's less than half a gram.
It was like, they said it was like the butt of a blunt or something. Like, not even anything, like, at all. Like,
yeah. So she got charged with possession of less than 2 ounces of marijuana, which is a misdemeanor and punishable by up to $2,000. Deputies didn't have a warrant for the search, and so this is thrown out. The resisting arrest charge was also dropped. So basically, she's not charged with anything. And now, and I talked about this in the last episode of Freethinker Radio, this we can add to the cost of these type of illegal behavior by the police, because now these two officers have been indicted, and the individual has filed a $15 million lawsuit against Harris County. So if y'all want to keep paying for this, don't do anything.
Yeah, think about that. So the cops get to go out there and be a-holes and touch and
act illegally,
people,
you know.
Break the law. And then if they get, if anybody decides to question them and challenge them, in just the rare possibility that the cop is actually held accountable, you pay for it again through taxes.
Yep.
So. That's a fun, that's like, you know, that's
racket.
A pyramid scheme. That's quite a scam to be involved. I mean, if you're on the receiving end of that, it's like, dang, we really got this figured out. These people just, no matter what we do, they have to pay for it. And I frankly am sick and tired of that. So if you're interested in looking for other solutions, we do want to invite you guys to come out and get involved in the Houston Freethinkers. Just a quick break here for to a conversation Micah and I were having before the show. And we've mentioned before how the Houston Freethinkers is kind of at an evolving point where we're shifting our focus, you know, maybe moving from hosting monthly meetings as we have done for the last 6 years. I've been, you know how on Facebook you get these like, this is what happened on this day. Really, this point 6 years ago in 2010 is kind of right at the beginning of the first public meetings that were being held in my house. And in just a couple months before I met Micah, and then, you know, go back to 2009, I could see at this point, for some reason, I guess the summer was just quite a time for me to start waking up to things, but right around this time. So it's just really reflective on where we're headed, where we've been. And it all really depends on those of you who are listening, who are involved. We know we have listeners who aren't in the city, but those who care about activism, I know that, and I've mentioned this on past shows, that I'm going to do more of an effort to kind of get back to what got the group moving in the beginning, which is making flyers, just putting up flyers around the city. I'd like to do more propaganda campaigns. You know, I've been thinking, putting up just simple things that say, big brother, big sister are constantly listening, do something about it, you know, find us, you know, things like just simple calls to action, trying to get people, because I think that's what really motivated. And when I see other groups like, the Grand Rapids Autonomous Support System, they call themselves GRASS. They're up there in Grand Rapids, Michigan. I did an interview with this guy, Tony, last week. They're just doing awesome work. When I hear about the things they're doing, it really reminds me of a lot of what we've done with the Houston Freethinkers. And just seeing other cities doing it, it's powerful. It reminds me of how good that feels to be involved in that community. And we still do have that community. It always ebbs and flows and goes through different cycles. But for those who are out there and who care about getting to the streets and talking to people, passing out flyers, maybe protesting, gardening, you know, doing community events, listening to music, just having a good time, being a part of these things, and you want to do this with other like-minded people who actually do care about what's going on in the community, please do contact the Houston Freethinkers Facebook page. You know, like us on Facebook, follow us. Don't hesitate to reach out, because we're all trying to figure out how we can take this energy that we've built up through Freethinker Radio, through our various networks, and take it in a positive direction. You know, continue focusing on solutions and building something really positive. I want to add to the story that you were just touching on, Micah. The new Harris County Sheriff who replaced Adrian Garcia in 2015.
They don't like those indictments.
He's kind of debating, going back and forth with the district attorney's office over these indictments. And it's interesting because, of course, you expect the sheriff to defend his officers, even if his officers are accused of illegally body cavity searching someone on the side of the road.
You'd expect the sheriff to defend your rights. I'm sorry, I had to say that in a weird way.
Well, I guess just at this point, I just expect them to defend each other, because they don't cross that.
Oh, yeah.
They don't cross that.
That's what they do.
The thin blue line, you know. But yeah, in an ideal world, we would hope that somebody whose job was meant something as far as actually protecting and serving the people, they would stand up for what was right, not just defending their own team. But the sheriff's office said the indictments came as a surprise to the Harris County Sheriff's Office after a lengthy internal affairs investigation cleared the deputies of wrongdoing. So they're basically saying, we already did our own investigation. We found nothing wrong. That should be no wrong. The district attorney doesn't need to go behind us. And they said that the sheriff's office said that the grand jury has no evidence, and that they're indicting these officers, quote, based upon a local news report about the incidents rather than actual evidence. And, you know, they said that it's just rumor, innuendo, and sensationalism. And then the district attorney's office responded, calling the sheriff's response disappointing on many levels. First, the suggestion that the grand jury has not reviewed evidence is spurious and uninformed. Although this office cannot disclose the substance of the grand jury's secret proceedings, we can disclose that the grand jury did fully and fairly review all of the available evidence. So they're basically saying, you don't know what evidence we have. The cops are trying to act all like, hey, they're just indicting them based on some, you know, sensationalist news reports. And the DA is like, hey, you don't know what we got. So I hope that these dirty cops that did violate this person and abuse their power, that they do, that they are held accountable. And I think if you care about this, maybe next time you're out in public.
What are the cops saying? Hey, we had a warrant. I don't believe they're saying that.
No, see, they're not even arguing that they had a warrant. They're basically arguing that by them laying you down or stripping you on the side of the street and, you know, taking your clothes off, that there's nothing wrong with that. They're saying that they weren't in the wrong.
That's the world they want.
And if you care about this, then maybe next time you're at a town hall meeting or something, you're out in public and you see the Harris County Sheriff, or, you know, they're hosting these things as they like to do, maybe you ask them a question. Say, hey, Chief, how come you defended those officers that, you know, basically violated and sexually assaulted pretty much that person on the side of the road? How can you support that? That's what I think the change will really start coming, is when people start educating themselves.
And these guys are the ones you can hold responsible, because they're right here in the same county as you.
On the local level,
they're not
for sure
way away in D.C. The sheriff is the, you know, highest ranking law enforcement in the county, because he is elected directly from the people. At least that's what's supposed to happen. So, you know, these are the ones that we, more than any others, ought to be out there questioning. I got another amazing officer here in the news.
All right, well, I'm going to follow with that. Actually, you know, let's go to a song, and we'll come back. We'll do a couple more stories, and we'll bring on our guest. Maybe he wants to talk a little bit about what we're doing, because Micah's got another cop story. I've got another cop one. For some reason, the Houston police have been in the news a lot lately, and it's because people are finally paying attention and realizing that, hey, you know what? Cops can kill people, they can abuse people, and they get away with it. And in Houston, as you're going to hear about more in a few minutes, Houston has a ridiculous record when it comes to actually holding officers accountable, and I'm sure you can guess how low it is. But we'll find out all about that and more when we return. You're going to listen to a song now from my band, Monankari. This is called Rebirth, from our debut EP, Closing the Circle, which we'll be playing live for the first time this Friday at night at Fitzgerald's. And you can come check it out for $5, hear a couple other bands, and have a good time. So stay tuned. We'll be back on Freethinker Radio. This is Monankari. Peace.
Mountains.
Yep.
I'd love to be able to play this music, share this music, and discover this music. And I hope you are, enthralled and thrilled to do that as well. And that any of this music that you really like, that you revisit or explore other.
Who was that?
Yeah, who was that? So Soon, the
that
Truth.
That was So Soon, the Truth. That was past and present. They're playing Friday night with Monkari, who was playing before that. And then earlier you heard Metanoia, and earlier you heard The Earth As We Know It. And they are all performing Friday night at Fitzgerald's. And in a few minutes, we're going to hear from Johnny, who is in Your Friendly Neighborhood Anarchist, who is also performing that night. But let's go ahead, Micah, and let's wrap up a little bit of this local political news.
I'm going to wrap it up fast.
I've got one more, and I'll let you do your last one.
I'll do, like, the bullet thing, because there ain't time.
But just as far as local for now, we'll get back to some more news in the later part of the show.
What you got?
All right, well, this one is related to, as we were just talking about, police getting away with, well, there's an indictment in that last case. We talked about the body cavity search, which is disturbing to hear, and it's disturbing to hear the sheriff defend the officers who are accused of pulling somebody over and violating their rights and violating them as a human being. But what's even more disturbing is to realize that whenever there are events like that, and specifically when there are officer-involved shootings, more than almost any other city, officers in Houston are found to be justified by the law enforcement agencies and usually grand juries. As we were just talking about the last case, the secret grand juries, they tend to find in favor of the officer. So even though there's an indictment coming from the district attorney, this doesn't guarantee, and based statistically on the past, more than likely the officers involved will not face actual charges from coming from the grand jury. So we'll have to see, because if so, it would be a change from the past. And this is an ABC News story that's talking about Houston specifically. It's titled, Activists Are Troubled by Houston's History of Police Shootings. The August 25th shooting of a 27-year-old man who'd been suffering from a mental health crisis. I mean, we can list the whole names. We've done this in past episodes. But the Houston police say that their training policies make it clear the use of unnecessary force or excessive force is not tolerated, that incidents of force are carefully reviewed, and that its training program on how to deal with individuals with mental illness and de-escalate dangerous situations is considered a modeled program, they say, nationally. But still, there are local community leaders and activists who are critical of what they see as the Houston Police Department's recurring issues with the use of deadly force. And although we've had people killed here, Brian Klontch and others, by the HPD, there was Brian Klontch, of course, is the paraplegic man who was in a wheelchair holding a pen that one officer apparently mistook for a gun and shot him dead. And, you know, many of us protested the Peaceful Streets Project, Houston Freethinkers. We went out and protested. We had people from other cities. But Houston really hasn't seen any of the major protests like you've seen in Cleveland, you've seen in Ferguson, and other large cities. For some reason, Houston doesn't have, I mean, there are definitely police brutality activists. There's police accountability activists, cop watching. There's those things here in the city, but we haven't seen it really coalesce into something large. And more people are recognizing that statistically the police officers get away with it more than, you know, any other city. The police, I'm trying to find the exact number, but they've, you know, they analyzed all the cases and basically just found, like, it said between 2005 and 2012, nearly all shootings by Houston police were deemed justified, including 99 incidents from 2009 to 2012, according to a review of court records and evidence. Gathered for recent lawsuits. And in the Houston Chronicle reported in March that the Houston Police Department has declared every intentional officer-involved shooting since 2010 to be justified, and that includes more than 150 officer-involved shootings.
Yeah, I'm kind of glad you're bringing this up, Derrick, because this is pretty pronounced here. I mean, there's been articles, just a few headlines, for example, in the Texas Observer. They're talking about this, and in Inquisitor, they're talking about, you were mentioning the activists suing, and there's a group of attorneys as well looking into the HPD's record of, always having that thrown out. And as I said, the Texas Observer has one of these articles as well. And, you know, I feel like sometimes, in their headline is Houston cops always justified in shootings, always. You know, so it's so pronounced. These aren't just from, you know, conspiracytheory.com. These are from Texas Observer, Channel 2, KPRC, CNN, etc. These are mainstream sources that are starting to recognize what's going on, because I guess it's just so pronounced. What do you think? I mean, I do think, is it just a trend?
It definitely, well, it's a combination of things. For one, the internet is allowing people around the world to connect and to say, hey, look, we have police violence here. We have police violence here, you know, and every single person now has...
But they ain't from Houston.
they have a cell phone or they have a, you know, a camera.
And we got police violence.
People are starting to organize and notice, but as I think we've talked about this on previous shows, though, but just because people are filming police... And just because there's articles and we all know about it, it doesn't mean that it's stopping or that we're, you know, keeping it. And the body cameras definitely don't seem to be a real-world solution. I've argued, and again,
there's articles out now speaking that they're not effective. You know,
yeah, I mean, I think it sort of creates like a false comfort situation. But I mentioned earlier the freedom cells, and I do hope that more people will look into that because one of the ways we've talked about using this concept of freedom cells of 8 to 10 people coming together and organizing is doing role-playing of how would you handle a situation with a violent police officer and how does your community respond to that, you know, filming, but, you know, also being able to, I think, eventually get to the point of disarming violent people the same you would anybody else violent that came into your community, you know, if needed be. So I think that those are realistic situations that people need to discuss and maybe looking to community alternatives, ways that we can protect ourselves that don't force us to rely on people that use and abuse us. But again, that still leaves the problem, as Micah has talked about earlier, of you're still paying for it with your taxes. So how do we solve that problem?
We just got to keep working on it. I got another one. The Houston Police Department, we haven't even got out of Houston. Officer accused of lying to obtain warrants. Imagine that, lying to obtain warrants. Turns out he's a 10-year veteran of HPD, and he's out of a job and facing serious charges. Charges stem from two separate DWI documents the officer wrote. He is accused of lying to obtain a warrant for blood samples from people he believed were drunk. In one incident, he is accused of knowingly making a false entry to try to defraud and harm a person whom he saw traveling west on Fairview at Montrose. Yeah, right down the street in the neighborhood.
Right in the hood.
Yep. This is truly community radio. He claimed that the woman didn't use her blinker while turning from Fairview to Montrose or while changing lanes at 2200 Montrose. He pulled over a woman and said he smelled alcohol in her breath, said she had a red, glassy-eyed, slurry speech, and told him that she had vodka before he asked...
What of it?
he said he performed sobriety tests and that he had previously used to determine whether a driver was under influence, claimed that the woman showed several signs of being drunk. Woman refused to provide blood or a breath sample. He then arrested her and took her to police station. The department is trying to determine how these charges will affect all the other cases that this officer has. He's been with the office since 2006. He posted a $10,000 bond and is out waiting trial. Also in Houston,
there was a cop that finally got sentenced for helping the Zika or the cartel.
Yes.
For I can't remember the name of the cartel. I'm thinking of the Zika virus, but
yeah,
something else.
It's all
the Zetas, I think. The Zeta cartel. HPD officer was like secretly funneling weapons and money to one of the drug cartels. I mean, this is Houston, baby. This is how we get down.
Yeah, and we got all these little fiefdoms around here, like Deer Park. We could sometimes forget about them, right? But they're here in Harris County. Turns out one of their officers is basically charged with assault after an arrest. Civil Rights Division of Harris County DA is investigating this officer with the Deer Park Police Department. And if you want to know these people's names, you can get all into it and go further back. I think it's more, he's out on a $4,000 bond.
They're walking the streets.
Yep, armed and dangerous, probably.
Armed and dangerous. Well, you wanna get into our guest now?
Yeah, we might as well. It's never going to end.
Yeah. Please do stay tuned to Freethinker Radio Facebook page. And if you've heard us go through these stories, you can check out in the top post on the page. Look in the comment section, all the stories we've been covering, if you want to read the gritty details yourself. But definitely, this is an issue. It's a real conversation that we want to have, and it's important for us to figure out solutions. And along with talking about the news that happens in our city and around the world and getting, you know, to focus on the problems, we want to focus on the solutions. A big part of that is building community, is promoting music and culture and music and art that promotes, you know, a paradigm shift in the way that we think about our relationship to government, to each other, our community in general, just looking for free thinking, thought. And part of that is interviewing local musicians. And today we have, as I said, Sparrow. We'll see if he wants to give out another name. I think I said it earlier on accident. Who is with my band, Monikari, plays drums, and also is your friendly neighborhood anarchist. So what's up, man? Welcome to the show.
How's it going, brother?
It's going well. You guys, thank you for being here. Introduce yourself. What do you want the audience to call you?
Yeah, you can just call me Jack or Sparrow. That's cool.
Okay, Jack. We got Jack with us today. So we wanted to get, I wanted to have you in here first to talk about, like I was just telling them, we're playing on Friday, so that's going to be kick-ass time.
Super exciting.
And I've talked about our band in the past, so I wanted to give you more a chance to talk about a couple of things you're involved in. First, you're also involved in with the North Houston Freethinkers, and we've had you call in the past to the show. So tell everybody just who may have not heard before a little bit about your involvement in, you know, activism and North Houston Freethinkers and just that whole part of your, you know, your stuff.
Okay. Well, obviously, I started going to the Houston Freethinkers, the branch in, you know, downtown. Y'all helped start about 2 years ago, and just couldn't get enough of it. Going to all the events, love documentary screens, all of that good stuff. And as time went on, as I live in Cyprus, it got pretty difficult to come out on a Wednesday night and go watch a documentary, though I was interested. So I kind of got inspired to start doing it on my side of town. So the people and friends of mine that were interested would, you know, they'd have an opportunity out over on the north side to, you know, maybe do a potluck in the park together, or, you know, talk about any kind of issues. We haven't really done any protests. We've mostly just been focusing on like the smaller projects like Skillshares and documentaries.
So kind of like just building up the crew and getting the thing started and getting the ideas out and having these conversations and stuff. I think a lot of the stuff we did in the beginning was just we turned it into fun. We're like, have a party, you know? And so we'd have a party, and in so doing, these ideas and conversations come up in a fun sort of way. It was actually, we can't say the name of the party because it's not FCC compliant, but we basically had a rad beep party, and people came and talked about rad beep. And,
oh, yeah, I remember that.
And, you know, that's where we picked up a lot of momentum in the early days. I mean, there was, you know, we were doing stuff before that and separate from that. But when, like you said, you've mostly done screenings and these sort of community building actions. So.
Yeah, I want to just add to that what Johnny was saying and what you're saying there, Micah. When I talked to Tony from Grass, the group I was talking about earlier that reminds me of HFT, what he was mentioning, it just kind of made me remember that. He was saying, you know, we don't really call it activism or do events. He's like, you know, we organize, like, meditation discussion groups or come feed the homeless or just different things that are getting people active and having fun while they're doing it. And then people realize, like, oh, wow, that... I mean, I remember one of the first phrases that I thought of as far as the Houston Freethinkers, I wanted to make a shirt, like, making it cool to give a, you know, since 2010. And because that was the general idea, just like we wanted to motivate people to care and start getting involved. And it's cool to see now you, Johnny, Jack, people like you. And we heard from Hector from Laredo. We've heard from Colin from D.C. He's come down to HFT events. We've got people in El Paso, just different people who have started other chapters within the city and in other cities. And that is really cool to me to just see how it picks up and people. It becomes something that people care about. So, and obviously that carries over into your music, you know, your musical career and life. So tell us a little bit about, you know, I guess how you started getting into music, and then how did your Friendly Neighborhood Anarchist first start?
Well, I've always loved music. I've always wanted to be a musician since I was probably like 10. But as I, like I said, when I started going to the Freethinkers, and always then I've been, you know, more freedom-minded. And finally with this band I'm in, some people call us YFNA for short, but it's your Friendly Neighborhood Anarchists. It's kind of like take on Spider-Man or whatever. But the idea is that, you know, we're not these crazy, like, wing nut guys who's going to go blow something up to try to save the world. We're just like those dudes in your neighborhood that are like planting a garden in their front yard, or we're just, you know, being outspoken about the different ways like you can get involved in your community and grow that way. It's just like being your friendly neighborhood, you know? And personally, I've felt like music has always been one of the most powerful outlets and one of the most powerful communicators for these kinds of ideas. Because, you know, whereas like, you have the mainstream radio and stuff, and they're not going to talk about, you know, anything about this kind of stuff, but there's always a scene if you're looking for it. So, I mean, if you care about these ideas, I just recommend you go to your local punk shows and your local metal shows, and there's going to be somebody talking about this stuff, you know? It's out there.
Certainly. As far as when you say that these things are out there, what have you ran into besides, you know, with the HFT out there that has really motivated you to recognize that there is something going on, even at these local shows, much less a big show? I mean, can you give us some examples, even if they're abstract? You know, I can think of a couple that I've had, like even just conversations. But has there been anything that's really just stood out to you, like where you like learned something or saw it in action or something like that? You know.
Yeah, I mean, whenever I go to shows, I always make it a point, you know, someone will mention something about something political, and I'm going to go ahead and, you know, leave my comments there, or, like, maybe we get inspired, or I take a, you know, an idea off someone else's who might know something I didn't. The best connection I had recently was actually when we opened up for Otanana Trio.
Oh, really?
Like, it was kind of like a reverse role, I suppose, for this, but after we played our songs, I had a kid in the audience come up to me and say, like, oh, wow, you know, there's not many bands talking about what y'all are talking about. Have you heard of, you know, government black sites? And have you heard about all this stuff? And he just wanted to say thank you. So I was like, in a way, I want to be that band for other people to be.
Y'all have a real unique approach compared to a lot of bands that do, I won't say cover the same material, but cover somewhat controversial / politico, socio issues. There's a number of, you know, well-known bands. In fact, I'd say rock and roll in itself, that's a bit of that nature in it. So, you know, that's not uncommon to rock and roll. But what is kind of really unique about your band is you all somehow managed to make it rockin', rebellious, and fun. Instead of rockin', rebellious, and just angry and, like, disappointed. Or, you know, we've seen all these things, disappointed, angry, sick of it, you know what I mean? And there's a time when you just get tired of, like, being grouchy about things.
Well, yeah, because, I mean, if you don't enjoy your life, then they win.
Yep.
You know, in my opinion, like, you know, you can't...
That's the ultimate victory, right? I mean...
Exactly. Well, I mean, like, just like when Elmer Fudd's chasing around Bugs Bunny all around, like, and Bugs Bunny does 1,000 things to piss him off, but what pisses Elmer Fudd off the most is when he kisses him on the lips.
Yeah, yeah.
And so, like, in a way, us saying, like, oh, you have all these oppressive systems, all these things...
It's like that flower in the barrel of the gun, too.
Exactly. Yeah. We're just like... Hey, you know, we're still having fun. We're still free. Like, people forget that. Like, we're free right now. I can do whatever I want right now. Like, you know, and when you just let that thought that, like, oh, there's no hope, debilitate you, then you're just letting them win.
Yeah. You're letting that system define your emotion. It's affecting you so much. You're letting that system define your reality. And in so doing, you're actually furthering that system. You know, you're like saying that is it. Instead of creating your own solution, your own song, your own art, your own radio, your own whatever it might be, or your communities, you know, your own baked goods, whatever, you know, you're letting that define you. And, you know, it's kind of sad. I'm glad that your band is able to reach people. And I think it's really a unique way. And I think that's pretty exciting. And I know all bands evolve, but at least in this period of creativity, it seems to be a lot like that. I liked some of the things you said about your merch. Do you want to talk about that?
Oh, yeah, man. I wish I had Trip here. Trip was the mastermind behind
it. Y'all's antics between the two of y'all, and you bring up Trip, is really a big part of the show. I mean, the music's there, but y'all's antics and the creativity and the way you approach these songs, the lyrics, and some of the, like I said, the little... dramatic.
We call them skits.
Yeah, the little dramatic pieces that occur. Really plug in the audience, for one, which is great for any band to be able to do. That's how you, you know, really build up a following and name recognition, which, you know, is good. And then, you know, two, engage the audience. And obviously you have a purpose that you want to engage them with. So, you know, all roads lead to Rome in a way. So as you bring them in with these skits and such, how do you feel those things serve the band? How do you enjoy them? Are they well received? Did you get better than you expected reaction from people? Or
Yeah, we've gotten all kinds of stuff. Like one of the earlier shows, back when me and Trip were just acoustic, we actually had my friend Michael in the studio with us. He wore a Barack Obama mask.
Obama in the mosh pit.
Yeah, we arrested him as a war criminal, and we sentenced him to the mosh pit. So We can use these skits the same way.
You know, that video got a lot of hits. You know, it really did.
It was
like early on, and when the video footage for the community went out, that was one of the leading ones early on, you know, until the band started getting traction of their own and were putting their... pushing theirs. But that one, you know, it really people wanted to know, you know, what is this? You know, they knew it's in a way what it was, but in another way they're like, how's this going to work out? What's happening here? You know, are these going to be crazy hater people? Or are these going to be, you know, what's going to happen? Is Obama going to mash them? What's you know?
Yeah, we didn't sentence him to death because, you know, that's making me the same as him. So we just...
Yeah, that's cruel and unusual punishment.
Exactly. So I think cool and... I still
he had to mosh,
unusual.
Huh?
Yeah, he had to mosh, you know. He had to face his people.
Yeah, so that was cute. And the last one, I thought it was kind of interesting that when you opened for Oto Nana, you had I guess what do we call these little bags?
YF&A jewelry
merchandise.
Piercing bags.
Yeah. So that you gave everybody memorabilia from the show, right?
And
you talked about, you know, how people can customize their own.
Yeah, we're like, please don't buy stuff from us. You know, take your Abercrombie shirts and go ahead, Sharpie that out.
Because that means a lot more, you know. That means a lot more than just, you know, simply supporting us with financial dollars. We don't need those as much. We, you know, that's cool, man. So you've played in Houston in bands for a moment now, and I guess we're going to probably get into some music. What would you say kind of motivates the musical aspect of what you play, the sound, the creative sound on the guitar? Where do you draw inspiration from, or what type of stuff moves you to play guitar or play instruments, period?
Okay, Fat Mike's my hero. I love NoFX. A lot of Nirvana as well, just like the way he structures his songs. I'm trying to like... I enjoy, you know, breaking out of that typical four chord progression where I'll put like six chords, or just, you know, instead of just verse chorus, I'll just put a bunch of nonsense. Maybe I enjoy writing songs that are like still have like the energy of the punk rock, the energy of the metal, and all these other rock and rolls that I love, but they're not. It's just like more like a child of all of these like different styles, instead of just like sticking to like a more bit, like I'm not trying to sound just like one guy, you know.
Well,
like,
what song are you gonna play some music for us, right?
Yeah, I'll play a song.
We should probably get into that. We can come back and talk some more. I'm glad that you're definitely one of the more comfortable guests, it seems. You know, a lot of times they're awkward.
I'm actually really nervous right now. No. I like talking to these Houstonians out there. What's up?
Oh, we got listeners in all over, as you heard Derrick saying.
Hi, Mom.
And we may well have our Australian audience and such. So, and we appreciate all the extra listeners that listen in to hear the community guests and the musical guests as well. So I guess at this point we should just take a moment to go ahead and get the sound right for you and get you on your guitar and mic it up and see how we can do.
What song you want to play for us?
I will do.
It's gotta be FCC. FCC.
Yeah, you gotta
supported.
Think. Dude, give him the list. There's five words.
Don't
or something.
Limit my freedoms on this radio show.
Yeah.
I will do my best to leave out the.
We used to.
We used to
be on an internet station and things were different. But I will give it to KPFT. We have as little control as possible from KPFT, and the only control that we have here is by the FCC saying that there's certain words that you probably wouldn't understand or would find the expression of obscene.
Okay, so. Well, maybe I'll play the Walmart CD version.
You can always like just, you know, we have our friend Falcon, F-C-K-E-R. We can't even say his name, even though there's no vowel in it. If we were to say his name without the vowel the way it is, properly, then we would probably get an FCC hit.
All right, well, let's set up. You're about to hear Jack from Your Friendly Neighborhood Anarchist, who is also playing with Monankari. Both bands will be playing with Metanoia, The Earth as We Know It, So Soon the Truth, and I think that's everybody.
And it's only $5. That's
five
a pretty
bucks,
good
yeah.
deal, man.
Five
shows
bands,
like this,
five bucks yeah. at Fitz. So
all
check
right.
this out. We'll get the volume set up and stay tuned. Thank you, guys.
Yeah, this is actually what goes on, because we don't normally just cut to something to get this sound and everything right. We got to kind of you know, a couple of microphones in a small room and doing what we can. I would highly recommend these once we get going. But yes, I'd like to invite everybody, check out kpft.org. There are ways you can contribute to advance music, activism, arts, and culture there, including your dollars, but not just your dollars. There's a barcode you can print out, go scan it with your Kroger card, and every time you purchase from Kroger, money will be given to KPFT at no cost to you. And that's pretty cool because we need that money to have these microphones and this electricity and water and be able to have a home for musicians and artists and such to come through and share what they have going on, which is obviously really important to free people and just people in general, you know. So thanks to all the artists, but most of all, thanks to KPFT, and thanks to you, the listener, that bothers to go ahead and do something, whether it's to contribute financially or share the links or print out that barcode and take it to Kroger. There's a similar program for Randall's, Good Neighbor or whatever you call it, where you give them a number and they always give money to KPFT. So we're going to get into it.
Okay, guys. This is an original. It's called Your Friendly Neighborhood Anarchist Anthem. It's a good song. So listen. Thank you.
you if you say you don't care. You're the reason this country has failed. You're too busy and too covered conceived. They do that to us, whether you believe it or not. We're gonna get screwed over. You should have listened. Starts with a whisper. Will you listen? Will you pass it on to someone who will pass it on to someone again? Unity can be our pistol. If we bless the soldier's body and the president's goddamn pen, let your ignorance be blissful. Just because you're unaware, you're happy with the oppression, need to start a resistance. If we want a better life for all of our children. Next to me, we can fight with peace to stop this war machine. You are not alone. We have a common goal to coexist as a whole.
Thank you. I know that was a doozy, guys. I thought you might like
that. That's epic. That was you know, that's those are the, those are good. Yeah, it's the YFNA anthem, right?
Yeah, I mean, for now.
Hey, for now. Yeah, you know, these things are up for revision. But yeah, it's pretty interesting. I like you go you cover a lot of material there lyrically, and you know, even the guitar covers a lot of ground. I'm pretty impressed with that personally, and look forward to listening to the archive to catch it, because there's so much in there. But I like that overall, you know, the message is, this is what's going on, and, you know, here we can do something about it. And it goes, you know, and the music's interesting, the guitar's interesting. So that's a good song. I'm glad that you performed it.
Thanks, man. That's a high compliment.
Yeah, that it is. Oh, no, I'm just joking. Stay hydrated. And you know, do you want to get into another number here? Maybe tell us about the next song that you might play. Are you?
You want me to play another one?
Yeah, if you're open for one more. You don't want to bend your arm, twist your fingers, or anything. But you know, if you got it in you, we can.
I sure do. I guess I'll play. I'll play the song that everyone seems to remember us for all the time, and it's got nothing to do with politics.
Oh, that's good. That's
well, I guess politics between species, because we're at an all-out war.
We are at an all-out war, and I actually have an article between Microsoft and Harris County about this species. They're going to combine their forces to resist this species.
Genetically modified mosquitoes, correct?
That's correct.
Yeah, so this is why we need a mosquito side, as we call it, but... The trip me and or this is a song me and Trip wrote outside, like it was like 20 degrees. We wrote it in about 5 minutes.
I bet the mosquitoes were biting.
Okay. Didn't ask for the blood transfusion. Parasites are full of pollution. Didn't ask for the blood transfusion. Wanna kill them with electrocution. Didn't ask for the blood transfusion. Parasites are full of pollution. Didn't ask for the blood transfusion. Wanna kill them with electrocution. I'm outside, this really sucks. These bugs are biting my nuts. Lit some candles and sprayed some spray. These guys won't go away. Like 150 fights to take. And that's just on my leg. Pesticides and DDT. Now I can't even breathe. Didn't ask for the blood transfusion. Parasites are full of pollution. Didn't ask for the blood transfusion. Wanna kill them with electrocution. Hard to replace all the F-bombs there.
Yeah, I could tell you were working at it.
Though.
Yeah,
I was doing a good job.
I was like, I bet this, you can figure out the actual original version of that song if you listen really closely.
That was obvious. I might have stuttered.
Good stuff. Good stuff.
Thank you, Houston.
Where can people find you?
Yeah, where can people find you, plug into your music, and catch you next?
We are currently, we're working on recording our EP. We got some nice little videos made by Red Pub. They do a great job at a Visionary Noise show we played. So we got some videos on the Facebook. You could go facebook.com/YFNAOfficial or probably just type in your friendly neighborhood anarchist.
Yeah, and the link to their Facebook page is there with all the source material and the chat string. We'd love it if you gave them a like because they're obviously working hard creating good music. Do y'all have SoundCloud or anything like that out there yet?
Not currently.
Y'all are a pretty fresh band.
Yeah. We've played like three or four shows so far. We got two coming up, though. So, obviously, the one this Friday, it's going to be a big deal. It's going to be a lot of fun. Bring your friends. Bring your family. Probably can't bring your dog. But
I don't know. You know, some of these venues are pet-friendly. I know Natsuo's is, but I don't know about...
I plan to show at Natsuo next Friday.
You should take your dog
after.
Or call and make sure, but I've been there, and dogs just come and go.
Everybody show up with your dog to Natsuo two Fridays.
Play a real loud show. Our dogs will be mad at y'all. Oh, man. But, yeah, that's exciting stuff, and you probably just expect more good music from your friendly neighborhood anarchist. Thanks so much for coming down to the station. Sharing this great music with us and the good times for sure. So, Derrick, we got 10 minutes left here. You got some things you want to get into, or should we just go insane on the... Yeah. You know, it's all over the place. And thanks, everybody, for listening and sharing, because that means the world. These articles matter. The ones that affect you personally are the ones you should be motivated by. You know, you can't care about it all. You can only... care about, you know, what you do. But I do want to mention the headline. I'm not going to go into the whole article, but
DWI arrests skyrocket after Uber and Lyft are kicked out of Austin.
Yeah, you know, I actually wrote an article about this a couple weeks ago about that situation, how, you know, basically there was a city council measure. It's similar to what happened here in Houston. They convinced the people that it was in their favor to try to vote or regulate out things like Uber and Lyft by making them comply with all the standards that, you know, the taxis have to. And Uber and Lyft, you know, while not perfect, they were providing the service. And they said, okay, if you guys pass this, we're going to leave the city. And they did. They carried out their threat and they left the city. And, yeah, because of that regulation, the DWIs have gone up because people haven't had an option. But what's also cool is because the market sort of, there's an opening there. And so somebody filled that spot. And it's called Arcade City, which is like an app. They're working on an app, but right now it's just a Facebook group. And that's the way they're doing it.
It's just like friends, right?
Like, yeah, ex Uber and Lyft drivers that are still in Austin but no longer have a job. Can they go in there and post a picture of their profile from Uber and whatever else in the Arcade City, need a ride? And then what's cool about it is it's decentralized, so it will be an app eventually that Arcade City will take a small percentage. But unlike Uber, Lyft, and all these other companies, the drivers can set their own rates. The drivers and the riders can choose what currency they choose to do, and so they can pay in Bitcoin. They can
do barter. Do you think it's going to last? They won't let this unregulated free
technically illegal.
Happen.
It's technically illegal right now. That's the interesting thing, which I think is really cool that the company is willing to do that. They're in the gray market, you know, almost the black market, and they are operating. I actually got to meet the guy when I was in Austin. He came to that Freedom Cells meeting I was talking about because they were sort of using, they call it pods is what they call their groups, like having little pods of drivers that can, and, you know, it's similar to the Cell 411 app and these other ideas that we've talked about, how to have community protection and community defense. You know, you send out a message, hey guys, I'm in trouble, and it goes out to everybody on your little list, and your people can come help defend you. Well, it's the same thing, but it's applied to decentralization peer-to-peer networks when it comes to driving. So I'd said before that I thought that Uber and Lyft were interesting and were cool ideas, but weren't really as good as they could be because they weren't as decentralized. And now I think Arcade City is providing an awesome alternative. Somebody like me who doesn't have a bank account, doesn't have a credit card, which is what's required, or a smartphone even, which is what's required with Uber and Lyft. I can pay using Bitcoin, and nobody has to know the difference. I just find somebody through there, and there is an Arcade City. If you search Arcade City Houston, you'll find the group on Facebook, and you can go in there. You can post, like, hey, I'm looking for a ride from here to here. The driver will contact you. You guys settle up and make the agreement yourself, and then you get a ride from somebody. You know, there's no reason a third party should be involved in that. And as Micah said, DWI is going up because, once again, the state is interfering.
It's taking an option to drive safely away.
Yeah, people are just having to, like, you know, screw it. I guess Uber and Lyft aren't around. I haven't heard about this.
It must be safer
for me to
drive.
This Arcade City, I might as well just drive drunk.
It's sad. It's sad. While smoking Kush.
Oh, God.
Because I can't smoke weed because that's illegal.
Yeah, and they made it illegal, so now I'm on probation.
This is the world they want you to live in.
Well, I guess I might as well just take pills. My doctor prescribed those, right?
And that heroin, it was got in Afghanistan. That's in those pills. No wonder the opiate addiction in the country's gone up. Keep sleeping. Keep sleeping.
Here's a couple others I have. One is just a real quick quote from, I thought this was timely. This is from 1852, July 4th, from Frederick Douglass.
I wanted to talk about this as well. I listened to James Earl Jones, then I dug into the whole speech. It's really long.
It's
but
pretty cool.
I saw the part that you had posted, and it hit some things that we only got a little bit of time, but I think we should spend the rest of it on this, actually.
So this is his from Frederick Douglass. If you don't know who he is, do a little bit of research and check out the history. But this is called What to the American Slave is Your 4th of July? And this is just a small portion of a larger speech, and we'll post the link to the whole speech in the thread. What to the American slave is your 4th of July? I answer, a day that reveals to him more than all other days in the year the gross injustice and cruelty to which he is the constant victim. To him, your celebration is a sham, your boasted liberty an unholy license, your national greatness swelling vanity. Your sounds of rejoicing are empty and heartless, your denunciations of tyrants brass-fronted impudence, your shouts of liberty and equality, hollow mockery, your prayers and hymns, your sermons and thanksgivings, with all your religious parade and solemnity, are to him mere bombast, fraud, deception, impiety, and hypocrisy, a thin veil to cover up crimes which would disgrace a nation of savages. There's not a nation on earth guilty of practices more shocking and bloody than are the people of the United States at this very hour.
You know, other parts of this, even after the 13th Amendment was ratified, I think it's still very relevant because he speaks about not having the moral high ground to other nations. He talks about these things. And if you remove the cause of slavery from what he's saying, okay, because we have the 13th Amendment that you know, legally ended slavery. So, you know, a lot of these things, as far as America and the way it's perceived, are still relevant today. And I thought, you know, we'd spend a little bit more time on that. You know, I thought that early on, because it was the 4th of July, we would be able to talk about these things. So I
think it is an important point. I posted that on Facebook earlier because, yeah, it's like, okay, what else do we really want to say about 4th of July? You know, I don't like to just contribute to negativity because every time there's an American holiday, especially something like Independence Day, social media, you know, contrarians like myself will take it as an opportunity just to voice our disgust or disapproval or whatever.
Well, let's go further than that, right?
But I don't want to just be contributing to negativity. But I do think that in general, what you're saying, though, is that his complaints and his arguments are still relevant because in many ways there are still slaves in the United States. And I think that his larger points, you know, discuss that.
I that may well be the case, but I'm going beyond that. The effects that he's putting to slavery, the effects of slavery on the American morality and psyche. And, you know, he talks about, you know, your liberty is false, these things. I think when you're drone bombing, having illegal wars, counterfeit money, and police state, that you basically have the same results as what he's speaking about in his speech. How independent can we be when you can't give a friend a ride in a car, when you can't feed more than five friends in the public spaces? You see what I'm saying? When your nation, the nation that you're told to pledge allegiance to for the first decade or almost two decades of your life before you even know what the word allegiance means, this nation of your fathers or whatever it's supposed to be, you know, is sitting here torturing people, you know, in Guantanamo and secret prisons around the world. So my point is, what is the 4th of July to a conscious individual?
Yeah, I think that it loses relevance once you start to recognize these things. And, you know, I was just kind of perusing the Democratic and Republican Party platforms, and neither of those parties, which are the major parties that people, you know, pay attention to and believe in the United States, neither of them have anything on their platforms, you know, of what they believe and what they're going to fight for that says anything about ending war, ending surveillance, or ending, you know, many of these issues that you're talking about that take away any sort of moral high ground that America may have once had, because the fact of the matter is that the United States, using American tax dollars, continues to torture people. There's, according to documents that have been leaked by whistleblowers like Edward Snowden and others, that 90% of targets of drones end up being innocent people, not the person intended. I mean, and just insane statistics that are continuing to happen here in 2016. So we're what, over 200 something years since the revolution fought in America, and I think in a lot of ways many would argue that America has become the empire that
I was going to go here with this because we're running out of time, but you know, if you're going to care anything about the 4th of July, what you have here is some people who only, you know, whatever you might want to say against them, their one thing was that they were sick of being ruled by someone else. Okay, so we can all sympathize with that to a certain degree. And when you go down and you look through and you read, the thing people forget is the Declaration of Independence is law in this land. I mean, that's what the Constitution and the Declaration are, the first legal documents of the country. And it says that when it is necessary for one person to dissolve political bands which have connected them with another, we're connected to these people that are drone bombing people, and to assume among the powers of the earth separate and equal status nature's law and nature's God have given them. And it talks about, you know, like you have a right to life, liberty, and pursuit of happiness. Do you feel like we have that now? You got to ask yourself, they're annoyed that the government they had didn't provide for their safety, happiness, or prudence, you know, and talks about how they controlled the laws, how they controlled the trade, how they controlled all these different aspects. The list is long. The Declaration of Independence is very long. And ask yourself, how can this be the foundational document of the nation we live in today? You know, so I just wanted to at least bring up, you know, what the, you know, we talk about this when we talk to the police officers, what the Constitution is supposed to point to, which is just rights you have, whether there's a Constitution or not. This Declaration of Independence is similar. It's just supposed to point to your right to exist and not be hampered by government. You know, of course, anything is perverted and taken further. And obviously, this is not the net land we live in. So, yeah.
Absolutely.
We're way out of time.
A lot of things to question and to challenge and to think of on this July 4th. Whatever you're doing, wherever you're at, we hope you guys are being safe and having fun. And be careful out there if you do go out and drinking and driving and celebrate, and watch out for the cops because they'll be doing...
they're an extra force for Kush.
They'll be doing... they're going to be doing the blood test so they can...
Oh, vampire. Vampire cops.
That. Vampire cops are out. So watch out for that. We're here every Monday from 3 to 5. If you want to stay tuned, my show with John Vibes covering addiction issues and music and more will be following in just a couple minutes. So stay tuned. Thank you guys for supporting us. Like us on Facebook, Freethinker Radio, Visionary Noise, the Houston Freethinkers, 90.1 KPFT Houston. As always, you are beautiful, you are free.
Go be beautiful and free.
Peace.